Holy Spirit, in this place this morning, that you will open our hearts to receive your word, that you will give your people wisdom and understanding. Help me to convey the beauty of what you've done through Jesus, through sending your son to die on the cross. Help us to have a little bit more understanding today than what we came with, and help us to remember in the future when we receive communion, the different things we learn here this morning. Love you. Thank you so much. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Today we're going to focus on the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Now, you know, even my oldest, this morning she asked me, and I know she loves to take communion, right? If she has to leave early and go to work, she'll ask me to meet her outside and to take communion, right? First, before service even starts, because she doesn't want to miss it. Okay. And even she today came and said, why are we taking communion today? Last week, how, right? Because last week, the first Sunday of every month, we have a habit, we tend to take communion. But I felt really strongly that God, you know, especially now we're studying, if you're following along on your reading plan, we've been studying the book of the law. We've been studying Leviticus. You should have started Numbers by now. And so I really felt God wanted us to think about it, give us more understanding. Last week, we focused and we talked about how God tested Abraham to bring his son to offer Isaac as a sacrifice, as a blood sacrifice. And instead of that, God himself provided the sacrifice in that story about Abraham. So instead of allowing Abraham to go ahead and kill Isaac, he said, wait. And he provided the sacrifice himself. We're going to see today that God has done the very same thing with us. God himself provides the sacrifice for our sin. So today I want us to think about that and to focus on communion again. And so before we even start studying and discussing, one reason we did not break down the tables today, we left them set up so we could pass out communion. You could have it in front of you while we're talking about it, okay? So if I could have volunteers come up and help. So take a napkin and just set it on there and just leave it there. We will later on take it, okay?
Got to. the butcher's diner or the butcher's office? What do you think? Game TV, game. Okay.
Okay, are you ready to go ahead? Are you excited to learn more? Anybody? Okay, so last week we did talk about how God provided Jesus as a sacrifice for our sin. And we read in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 11 through 14. We read how day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest, meaning who? Remember who? This priest has offered for all time one sacrifice for sin. He sat down at the right hand of God, and since that time he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. For by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Under the old covenant, they presented sacrifice after sacrifice again and again and again and again, even though it would not forgive the people's sin. It was a temporary covering. It did not have power to forgive sin. It only provided something temporarily. Jesus was able to make one sacrifice of his own life to cover sin for all people for all time. So that is the big difference. If we go back to the beginning of chapter 10 in Hebrews, start by just reading verses 1 through 3. It tells us that the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly, year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, would they have not stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. So the people had to continue bringing their sin offerings to the priest to make a sacrifice because they continued feeling guilty because of their sin and their wrongdoing. So they had to bring that sacrifice. They knew they were satisfying the law. But here, Hebrews tells us what? That's only a shadow. It's only like showing us the real thing, the heavenly things are there. We have this, it's not exactly the same, but gives us like an example, a picture of the real things that we have in Christ and have in heaven, the things that God himself has prepared. So we see that the sacrifices were a reminder of their sin. It was to remind them about their guilt. So, and that's what the law does. The law, read the law, you remember, I failed that one. We remember our guilt and our sin. Well, how many of you have perfect 10 commandments? Never, right? Kyle, we've already all broken the 10 commandments. And you know what? Does it help people? Does it change their lives to give them more rules? You can set up. We know working in the dorm, right, Viola? We know you can set up plenty of rules, but if that student, if that kid's heart doesn't change, They're going to find a way around the rule. They're going to find a way to break that rule. So the law has no power. The rules, the laws, they weren't established to help the people change, to make them perfect. Their purpose, to remind them they weren't perfect. To remind them, yes, they have sinned against God. So the law looks forward to Christ accomplishing what the law itself could not do. Christ can do the law can't. So what happened under the law? Why is it important for us to understand the law? So let's take a look at that shadow. And I like to think of it, a picture I like to have, is that those sacrifices are like a shadow made by the image of the cross, the light coming down. And you have the cross. That's the real thing. That's the sacrifice God has provided. And these animal sacrifices are a shadow of that. It's looking forward to what Christ can do. But let's read the law. What does the law say? You know, there's several different kinds of offerings. We talked a little bit about them last week. We named the different ones, right? So today we're just going to focus on the sin offering and what the requirements were in Leviticus chapter 4. The Lord said to Moses, say to the Israelites, when anyone sins unintentionally and does what is forbidden in any of the Lord's commands, if the anointed priest sins, bringing guilt on the people, he must bring to the Lord a young bull without defect as a sin offering for the sin he has committed. He is to present the bull at the entrance to the tent of meeting before the Lord. He is to lay his hand on its head and slaughter it there before the Lord. Then the anointed priest shall take some of the bull's blood and carry it into the tent of meeting. He is to dip his finger into the blood and sprinkle some of it seven times before the Lord in front of the curtain of the sanctuary. The priest shall then put some of the blood on the horns of the altar of fragrant incense that is before the Lord in the tent of meeting. The rest of the bull's blood he shall pour out at the base of the altar of burnt offering at the entrance to the tent of meeting. Now we're not going to read all of Leviticus, the whole law. After that, they removed the fat, they burned that on the altar, and then the hide and the flesh, they burned outside the camp, outside the whole community, for all the community. Now that one bull was for if the priest did something wrong without meaning to or unintentionally sin. If we read further in verse 13 through 18, it says, if the whole Israelite community sins unintentionally and does what is forbidden in any of the Lord's commands, even though the community is unaware of the matter, when they realize their guilt and the sin they committed becomes known, the assembly must bring a young bull as a sin offering and present it before the tent of meeting. The elders of the community are to lay their hands on the bull's head before the Lord, and the bull shall be slaughtered before the Lord. Then the anointed priest takes some of the bull's blood into the tent of meeting, and again dips his finger in the blood and sprinkles it before the Lord seven times in front of the curtain, and then again puts blood on the altar, on the horns of the altar, and pours out the rest of the blood. And the same is done as before. And then it goes on to list who brings what. When a person sins, if it's a leader, they brought a male goat. He himself kills it. The same is done for any, and the same is done with the blood. Any community member brings a female goat, and the same is done. They themselves kill it, and the same is done with the priest using the blood. And then it goes on and talks about if they realize their guilt because they didn't testify about something they had seen and they let something continue without there being justice, if they touched something that wasn't clean, if they made a careless oath. And then, so we've summed up all that. And then in chapter 5, verses 5 through 6, it says, when anyone realizes their guilt in any of these matters, they must confess in what way they have sinned, and as a penalty for the sin they have committed, they must bring to the Lord a female lamb or goat from the flock as a sin offering, and the priest shall make atonement for them for their sin. You know, if they were poor, there's also parts of the law where they could bring birds, like doves or pigeon, or even flour if they were poor. So what is this teaching us about the cross? We read all this about the animals and that the person themselves brought it and killed it. And then the priest used the blood, sprinkled it before the curtain, poured it out at the base of the altar. Why is that a shadow of what was going to happen later on the cross? It teaches what? The cost of sin. Cost of sin is high. They didn't just go down to the bull store and buy a bull, bring it, and kill it, right? They didn't just go in the grocery store, oh, here's meat, I'll bring that and sacrifice that. No, what they do? Remember, when they left Egypt, they were shepherds. They took care of animals. They raised them from when they were young, and they fed them, and they took care of them. How many of you have had a pet before? Or if anybody knows somebody, I've known some girls way back in the day that did like 4-H, and they would raise a animal. They were precious, and they would take care of them. And, you know, and I'm sure that, you know, they would have to use them sometimes for food and for their family, to support their family. But those animals were precious to those people. We don't look, you know, when we eat a hamburger now or steak, we don't think, but oh, I miss my friend Bessie, you know, that I raised and took care of. No, we don't think at all about it normally. But the truth of the matter is, the cost of sin is high. The cost of sin that impacted them, and why this was important for them, is because those were animals they did raise, and they took care of. And they had to bring it in front of the public, so everyone would, ooh, I see my friend, he has a goat, he's going to the tent. He did something wrong, he did sin. Can you imagine the gossip? If you were seen taking a goat to the tent, right, to bring to the priest, the word would get out that you had sinned, you had done something wrong. Second of all, you yourself, you had to take that animal that you raised and you took care of it, and you had to take it by its head, and you had to kill it yourself. The priest didn't kill the animal for you. You yourself learned, my sin killed my animal that I raised and I took care of. My sin did that. My sin took that animal from my family that it could have helped take care of my family. And I have to kill that animal because I did something wrong. They understood, I think, more clearly than us sometimes, the price of their sin. Even when it was unintentional, when they didn't know they were sinning and doing something wrong, when they had guilt, they brought the animal and they had to kill it and sacrifice it before the Lord so they could have a temporary covering for their sin. And for the community, they said it was an annual reminder. So they had to continue being reminded of their sin. Those sacrifices, they were only a temporary covering. They did not finish the work.
You, the sheep, takes the place of the sin.
Back then, it provided temporary. It was obeying the law that God had established. But God says this law just reminds them of their sin. It doesn't forgive their sin, but it covers it temporarily. So their guilt can be relieved, so they can still
Thank you.
Had like a right relationship. It wasn't a permanent covering. It wasn't forgiveness like we have in Christ. It just was temporary to be obedient to God's law. And it served as a reminder of their sin and their guilt. But that, you know, that picture, I mean, look at that cup in front of you. Think about killing an animal you raised, you took care of. I mean, the blood probably splattered on you. You know, they understood the impact of it, that the cost of sin is high. And if we read in Hebrews chapter 9, and we're going to be going back a lot between Leviticus and Hebrews. Verse 1 through 7, this part. It says, now the first covenant had regulations for worship and also an earthly sanctuary. A tabernacle was set up in the first room where the lampstand and the table with the consecrated bread, and this was called the holy place. Behind the second curtain, there was another room. What's that called? The most holy place, which had the golden altar of incense and the gold-covered ark of the covenant. This ark contained the gold jar of manna, Aaron's staff that had budded, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Above the ark were the cherubim of the glory, overshadowing the atonement cover. We cannot discuss these things in detail now, but when everything had been arranged like this, the priest entered regularly in the first room, in the outer room, to carry on their ministry. So they brought the blood in there, right? They took care of ministry in there. But the second room, the inner room, says only once a year did they go in there. Never without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins the people had committed in ignorance. So that most holy place, even the high priest himself, only went in once a year and never without blood. Just to even go in there in the holy presence of God required bringing blood. The cost of sin is what is death. No, the cost of sin is death. And blood must be shed to approach God's holiness. Understand when you see that picture of the bull being slain, and understanding the cost of sin and how that would impact the Israelite people, and understanding that cost, we can understand more about what God did by sending His Son on the cross to die for us, but also God's own desire to be close to His people, to His creation. He longs to be with us and not be separated from us. Now that cost has been paid, right? We read some of that. Let's read again in Hebrews chapter 4. So we're going to talk about the cost being paid.